Namaste, Vanakkam, and a very good evening to one and all watching us today from the community. Well, today we have with us two special people, and these people whom I call the superheroes of the universe are here with us sharing the screen. And they're special because both of them, in some way or the other, have actually played the role of giving a second life to their loved one. So wherever you are this evening, I'm going to request you to please put your hands together for a big round of applause for Mr. Ganesh and Shraddha, who are donors for their respective spouses. Well, in this particular session, we're going to be diving a little bit into the journey of what inspired them to become donors and life after becoming donors. So without further delay, I'm going to move on to introducing our first guest for this evening. We have with us Mr. Ganesh. Mr. Ganesh, can you share a few words with us about your family, your wife, how long you've been married, and then we'll move on to Shraddha.
Thanks, Marian, for that wonderful introduction. My name is Ganesh. I'm 68 years old. My wife, Uma, is 63. We have two sons, Siddharth and Aditya. They are living in London and Australia. We are married for 38 years now. And I used to be an executive in a large IT company, multinational company. I retired about 9 years ago and enjoying my retired life. That's pretty much about me.
Thank you, Mr. Ganesh. And Shraddha, a few lines about you, please.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. And nice of your introduction. My name is Shraddha, and I am a donor to my husband, and I am 29 years old, and my husband is 34 years old. I have a small kid, 4 years old, and I have been married since 7 years. So I was working earlier as an insurance executive for 2 years. Now I am a housewife. That's it.
Great. So we have two people on the screen, one who's been married for 7 years and somebody who's been married for 30 years. And it's amazing to see how love has just been a part of this journey for both of you all. So now let's move on to the next part where I'm going to ask you both, since you both have had your own glimpse of the journey on CKD, I'm going to first ask you, Mr. Ganesh, can you tell me when were you introduced to the journey of CKD and what it felt like to begin this journey?
I come from a family where my father himself was a physician. So I'm pretty much aware of, to some extent, about human anatomy, physiology, and all these stuff. You know, way back in 1980, my brother-in-law had CKD. Way back in 1980, when probably dialysis had not even come to India or just started then. Okay, even you must remember Jayaprakash Narayan and others had dialysis in just look Bombay. So it was those days. So I'm fairly familiar. I've been sitting near a dialysis machine even as an young boy of 28, 29, and I've gone through that. So it was okay with me. My wife suddenly, you know, she lost some weight, and then we did a routine urine check and a blood check. And we found that her protein leakage was plus, which was quite scary at that time. Then we consulted our physician, and we had an ultrasound scan and found that the kidneys had shrunk in size. He referred us to our nephrologist, Dr. Ravichandran, one of the leading nephrologists in Chennai. And he did a renal biopsy and confirmed that it is an autoimmune disorder called amyloidosis. So the news came the first time when we heard that, even though I was prepared, my wife was not prepared for that, and the family was not prepared for that. We received that news with a lot of dismay, and you know, we were with disbelief. How can this happen to us? That is the initial reaction. But then slowly, you know, the entire family supported us, and we got acceptance of the fact that this is it's not going to get well. I mean, being from a medical family, I knew that it's not going to get well with medicines or anything. We need to fight with that. And then that's how it started. That's how we found out that she had this chronic kidney disease called amyloidosis. And unfortunately, her brother also has that. So it's a sort of familial amyloidosis. So he developed that subsequently.
So everything settled down after the word acceptance, and then there came some clarity of how to move forward with the journey.
Yes, because we have a large family. I have three elder sisters, And I have two younger brothers. My father was there. My mother was there. So the entire family rallied behind us. I think her brother, her parents, everybody rallied behind us. I think that's very important for us to understand that the family support is very, very important in such a serious condition and situation. Yeah, that really helped us. And to boot, I was a qualified psychologist. So obviously I had to pitch in with my pitch. Even though she was my wife, I had to tackle that as well.
We're going to come back to the family scenes in a short while from now. But before that, Shraddha, can you tell us your initial days on the journey of CKD?
Yeah. The first thing, my husband was suffering from hypertension several past years. So suddenly he got a weight loss, and there was a foamy urine for him symptom. So we just showed to a doctor and where he was consulting. So they got to know that his kidney becoming damaged. So he started getting a symptom of weight loss and weakness. So they told to show to nephrologist, and then we consulted to the nephrologist, and the benefit was his sister was a doctor. So she guided us about all these things, like transplant is good before going to dialysis. Either she explained me the process, everything, either it's a dialysis or transplant. But the young, both of us were young, so we thought to go for transplant. So this made us a good decision to take away.
Remind me of your age when your husband was diagnosed with with CKD. How old were you and how old was your husband?
My age was 29, same. And his age is 34. So we just recently got to know in July.
This was recent past, last year?
Okay. No, this last month, July.
Oh, last month. Okay, so you're a new donor then?
Yeah.
How long back did you donate? How many days, how many months back?
1 month back. It was, our surgery was on 19th August.
Okay. Great.
So dialysis for 3 days starting, has his creatinine was more. So 3 to 4 sections has done for him. That's it. And fourth day, we went to transplant surgery.
Nice. Okay. Thank you. So let's move on to the next part of the journey. So you've got to know that your loved one has begun the journey of CKD, and like everybody in the community, the initial part, the initial hours, the initial days, sometimes weeks are quite overwhelming until we learn to accept the journey, and then the decision making starts of dialysis or transplant. When I got to understand the sneak peek of both your stories, both your spouses weren't on the journey of dialysis for very long, which means it was a very prompt attempt or reaction from both of y'all to become instant donors. So let's get into the part of you guys telling us, when did you pitch in to become a donor? Shraddha, can I start with you?
Yeah, fine. The thing is, when we got to know about this, we were shocked actually, but we made a positive mind so that we can support each other in a future days. And even for his young age, I thought it's good to decide early stage. So just we went to doctors and they cleared my test and everything was done. So positively, they told me your reports are normal, so you can proceed with the transplant. So that was a good experience and good happiness to me to donate to my husband. So that was a reason.
Shraddha, I'm going to ask you another question. How did it feel to take that decision having a 4-year-old child?
Yeah, the decision was very tough for me to handle it. But the main supportive people are my husband and my mother and father. They supported me a lot, like a backbone. And they told everything will go smoothly, don't worry about your kid, we will take care of of your kid. So if they have not supported me, I could have not gone further. So they positively accepted everything, and I also positively took everything, so everything got smooth. Well, that's
so beautiful. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, Mr. Ganesh, and your part of the journey.
Yeah, hats off to Shraddha, because I think it's a very tough journey for her with a kid and all that. I think we were more fortunate because we had already been married and children had grown up. See, one thing about CKD is unlike her case, in our case, it was identified in 2000. And I knew that even it was quite surprisingly, though the proteinuria was there, the creatinine and urea were normal. So one thing people should understand that CKD is not like a heart attack. Something happens and overnight you're gone. No, it takes years and years for the kidney to, really give up. It tries its best to work for many years before it ultimately gives up. This is the fact that most of the people forget. And as soon as you hear that the kidneys are failing, immediately they get panicky. So we were aware that nothing is going to happen the next day. So fortunately, doctor, our nephrologist took us through medication and it lasted for 16 long years. 16 years we were on medication. And I'm a very patient man. Patience is my virtue. So going to the hospital every month, tests, waiting for the doctor, and I don't get frustrated quite easily. So that helped me a lot. So I took her there. And after 16 years, the moment of truth came when the creatinine levels crossed 6. Our nephrologist told that now is the time, you can't prolong any further, she has to go in for a dialysis. And he said that, why don't you go in for a peritoneal dialysis? My wife had undergone 2 cesarean sections, so she had a mesh implanted in her for hernia. So he said, you consult the surgeon and come back and tell me whether she's fit for implanting those peritoneal dialysis equipments. So I went and had he was testing her and I was sitting in the chair watching. It was at that moment, something struck me. Instantaneously, I decided, why can't I donate instead of going through all the hassles of this dialysis? Then I was quite anxious because our meeting with our nephrologist was the following week. I was just ruminating whether he will agree. 2 reasons. One is whether it should match. Number 2, I was already 63. Whether he will accept me since I was fairly old at the time. Then I told him and he immediately looked at me and said, why not? Then he said, first of all, let me see whether you have 2 kidneys. So I said, sure, doctor, definitely. Then the workup started. So fundamentally, it was a decision that was made instantaneously. And my wife also accepted it. My children accepted it. All my daughters-in-law accepted it. Both my sons were married. My daughters-in-law accepted it. My older sisters, everybody accepted it. And I had no hesitation. And here I would like to add that many people while giving donors, they are really worried. What is going to happen to me? There is a self-preservation, right? After all, our physical well-being is the most important one. So did I worry about it? Of course, I did not. For the simple reason that I came from a doctor's family. I've seen all this before. Number 2, I had very close family relatives who were given donated kidney. And I've been surviving for 30 years, late into their 80s. So I knew that people survive. 3rd, as I was mentioning sometime before, I had a cousin who was having an ultrasound scan for the first time in his life at 68. And surprisingly, they found that he had only 1 kidney. So I knew that God means that he has given us a backup. Even with 1 kidney, you can survive as a normal human being. That is the first aspect of physical well-being. The second aspect is psychological. See, people get terrified what happens, what is the risk involved, etc. And from a physical perspective, I'm sure that I was very confident about our nephrologist taking a decision. If there is even the slightest of risk for me, he would not do that. So I was very confident that he will take the kidney out only if I'm 100% fit. Psychologically, I told you I was already a psychologist. I counsel people on various issues, including health issues, organ donation. So obviously, you practice what you preach. So I can't get perturbed by donating a kidney. The 3rd aspect is a philosophical aspect. After all, other day somebody had posted in the Kidney Warriors that when he asked his doctor after the transplant, how long would the kidney survive? He said, it doesn't matter how long, but what you do in between is what that matters. Be joyful, be helpful, have a healthy, happy life. So that is true. So whether you have 1 kidney or 2 kidney, ultimately, inevitably, everybody has to leave. So it doesn't matter whether you have 1 kidney or 2 kidney. So philosophically also, I was quite convinced that it is the right thing to do. And I'm very happy that I did the right thing.
Thank you, Mr. Ganesh. And Mr. Ganesh actually smoothly took us into my next question also. And that was mentally and emotionally, the mind of a donor. Yes. What actually happens in the mind of the donor? Mr. Ganesh gave us a sneak peek of what actually happens. So Shraddha, can you tell me, you also gave us a sneak peek in terms of having a child who was only 3 to 4 years old. All the reasons why you should not have donated in the world was right in your hand, but you still took it up and said, no, I want to be a donor. And I went through the process also at one point of time to become a donor. So I kind of know the psychological and the emotional feelings that could go as much as the heart is willing. I chose to believe that there are times that the donors have the sense of fear. Am I doing right? Is it safe for me? Will I have a kidney failure? What will happen to my children after that? And there's so many other hidden small fears that happens, which I need to hear from you guys, because since you guys have actually put the act into action, that it is normal for every donor to have this kind of emotion. But at the end of it, the act of love should win. So can you tell us your own journey of the same in your own words, Shraddha, please?
Yeah, I voluntarily opted as a donor. I thought to support my husband more, first of all. And even in the difficulty time, we should be together, we thought. So I just came forward to donate. As my test became positive, everything, touch wood, so I got to transplant. They told that you are eligible to transplant to your husband. So yeah, emotions were there. How I should give to my husband? How long will this process takes me? How he gets cured after the transplant? Everything questions were there in my mind, as I have a small kid. So the thing, we spoke to transplant patients, what they have gone through, the whole situation, how they faced it. And according to their feelings, we thought, we just positively accepted every situation. And if they are like, if they are coming forward to donate their loved ones, so even we can be a positive minded to donate our loved ones. Yeah. So this came to mind to me, to donate to my husband, positive minded, with the positive mind, I have donated to my husband. So this came.
Thank you, Shraddha, for that answer. Thank you. And such a beautiful act, I should tell you once again. Mr. Ganesh, since you already told us of how your emotional, your emotional needs, your physical needs, everything could be overwhelming at that period. And you were very honest about when you mentioned that you had the sense of fear. You had the sense of, am I doing the right thing? But in spite of it, you knew that that was the right thing to do. And being a psychologist, I think you will be able to tell us in a nutshell how the mind has the ability to play these games and keep you double thinking if you're doing the right thing. It could even be for a second. But being a professional coming from us, from this background of a psychologist, can you tell us a little more about your professional and your personal experience with this organ called the brain or the mind?
See, fundamentally, the whole life revolves around your mind. See,
absolutely.
It always plays games with you. So the first question that comes up is, what happens, like you rightly said, what happens if my kidney fails? What will happen to me? So that self-preservation is the highest form of self-love. So that is, nobody can say that I don't want to survive and do my best for others, etc. So that is the most critical aspect of any human being. Second is, in my own case, while I was very firm and my family was supporting me, there are a lot of well-meaning friends. They will call and tell you, why do you want to give? Suppose both of you fall sick, who will take care of you? Both your children are abroad. So it's very difficult to handle these well-meaning friends. So these chaps put you down. So you need to be on guard all the time about these friends. Third aspect is, there are another set of well-meaning friends who say that don't go in for transplant. It is not very successful. Go in for touch therapy. By just touching you, your kidneys will become all right. Go for homeopathy. Go for Ayurveda. Go for Siddha, etc. So these are all issues that crop up for every single person. And honestly, I say that I have given a kidney to my wife, but I would have given it to anybody. It's not that I have given it just because she's my wife. I would have given it to anybody if there was a requirement. That was my mindset. And number two is, my humble request to all the people is, because we go by science and research and data and, you know, tried and tested methods, don't go fall for arguments of going in for alternative. I have nothing against alternative medicines, but don't go in for that at the cost of allopathy medicines, which is tried and tested. It has its own pitfalls, but I'm sure it is better than groping in the dark with other people. So these are all issues that one has to handle in a very mature way. And, you know, the rational mind always plays tricks. It always says that what happens if this is there? And nothing ever, like Mark Twain said, most of your worries in your life has never happened. So all you do is you keep on worrying what happens after 5 years. So today you have a transplant, you don't think what will happen after 15 years, whether the kid will be lost or not. So that is where problem starts. So in my mind, I was very clear that I was quite fit. And unless I'm cleared as fit by my nephrologist, I will not be allowed to give a kidney. I didn't have sugar. I didn't have BP. My heart was perfectly all right. I didn't have any other ailment. So what is the problem? So that was my logical argument.
Thank you, Mr. Ganesh. I think you beautifully brought in the two aspects of the mind. Even if you're so convinced, I found this with many donors. In fact, I found myself in the situation once also. Even if you're convinced of the act of organ donation, you have so many other people who are your loved ones. It could be your immediate family or friends who really love you and out of their own emotional love for you, but because of their lack of knowledge and understanding on organ donation, they tend to complicate the mind of the donor. I see this happening in the life of every person who wants to become a donor. There would at least be one, more than them fighting their own thoughts. Most of the time, a donor has to fight the thoughts of everybody else around him or her, because everybody Absolutely. Else has an aspect of what things that you're not thinking. Also, they would come and put it into your head. And at that time, the donor is so vulnerable that even a small thought would seem so big. What will happen to your child? What will happen? Will the transplant be successful? What if both of you all are sick? So these are the repeated thoughts that come in. And Absolutely. It's maybe wrong to say this, but it's nice to know that everybody goes through this. So this is a common questionnaire. I think that all donors should be advised, be aware of these questions, or rather answer yourselves these questions first before becoming a donor. So when the outside world actually comes to you and asks you these questions, you're already ready with the question paper answers to give them an answer, and you're not shaken about it during your time closer to the organ donation. That brings me to my next question that you already spoke to us, Mr. Ganesh, but since you have the experience of life when compared to both Shraddha and me itself, the importance of the family support. When I mean family, I mean blood relatives, friends, in terms of creating a positive mindset for the donor, because Shraddha mentioned the promise that a mother or father just gave her that, don't worry, I will take care of your child, was motivating enough for her to go to the act of love. So can you tell us why it's important for us people to support people who want to donate their organs, and what happens to the mind of the donor at that point of time if they receive that support?
Yeah, exactly. So each person, each donor situation is slightly different. In my case, I was already passed. I was already retired. My children were all settled. I had in a very loosely, if I can say that, I have nothing to lose, right? Whereas in Shraddha's case, it's very different. She needed much more support than me because she's got a child that has to be brought up, and you know, both of them will be sick for some time. And even in my case, both of us would be hospitalized. Both my daughters-in-law had come. My brother lives with me very close to my own apartment. My brother was there. My sons had flown in from abroad. So it's nice to see that people around you are supporting you, you know, taking your decision, even, you know, however strong you are. In fact, to be honest with you, the first day after my surgery, I woke up, the pain was so severe, though I had a laparoscopic nephrectomy, the pain was so severe. I said to myself, why did I get into this? Then I told my nephrologist the next day, this is what I felt. He said, you are making a big fuss. Earlier days, we used to open half the stomach and take it out. Now we have done such a small surgery. Why are you making a fuss? Then I was feeling very, very bad for the next 2-3 days. I recovered well. So those are all times when you need support from family, not only during the before surgery, even after surgery or during surgery. Then I met another person in the hospital. Then he said he had given it to his sister. Without my telling him, he said the same thing. The pain was so much that I felt, why did I get into this? Then I felt that I was not alone. I was greatly relieved that, you know, it is quite normal to feel. So what I'm trying to drive is, however strong you are, all of us need support. Nobody can say, I am extremely strong. I don't need any support. I don't need friends. I don't need family. So it's very important. It is slightly more or less depending on what stage of life you are. Like Shraddha's, giving us much more complex than what I have done. I think really hats off to her. She needs all the support from her family, husband's family, her parents, even the child, because he will see her mother is sick all the time, at least during the surgical time. So it's important. Family support is most critical. And being a psychologist, I can tell you, even any mental illness, it needs the support of the family. And like, you know, we were just talking about it, like you get into mood swings. People, even after transplant, they go into mood swings. The whole family is very supportive. Even today, 5 years after the transplant, every single small problem for my wife, my sisters, all 2 sisters are abroad. They call every other day to talk to her, ask her how she's feeling. Should we do some puja for you? Things like that. See, that is very, very important. And fortunately, in our system, it is really much better compared to some of the Western countries.
That brings me to another question, Mr. Ganesh. What you thought just few hours after transplant when you woke up, why did I put myself in this situation? 3 days once you went back home, did you ever think of that question again?
Never, never again. I think it was, see, when you undergo the surgery, you are probably at the weakest point in terms of physical strength and also your mental strength, right? So those are all moments when your normal facade of strength or your rationality gives up. So that is when you get into trouble. So that is when you need support. All of us need support. Nobody, like I said, nobody can say that I don't need support. So fortunately, my brother, my sons, they were all around. So I got over that.
Shraddha, the question that I'm going to ask you is something that I actually don't find much donors talking about. And I'm not sure if it's a very common thing, but I personally witness it with a few donors. In the 24 hours to 48 hours after surgery, the emotional vulnerability of the donor. Because at the end of it, the recipient is receiving something that he doesn't have, but the donor is giving something. So the donor is losing something. Did you feel any emotional swings, 24 hours to 48 hours, hallucinations? Was it common for you?
No, common symptoms were not there. The pain was very more. So with the anesthesia, anesthesia was given to me. So through that 2 days, literally I was in deep sleep, like sleeping, waking up, asking for water, asking for liquids, drinking them, and again go back to sleep. As the pain was more, they were giving me painkillers and antibiotics. So frequently they used to inject me painkillers and antibiotics through my body. So that the pain was more, that's it. The pain was horrible, that's it.
And how many days were you in the hospital?
I was for three days, that's it.
And when you went back home on the fourth day, you were perfectly normal?
Yeah, I was walking perfectly normal. Third day itself, the morning they came doctors and made me to walk and talk to others. Normal, I live normal life, be friendly with others. Talk, don't think more about how your health goes on through after the transplant. So they told like get up, be active, walk by yourself, try to walk by yourself without support, that's it. So even they helped us more.
And now, since you're a new donor, is your creatinine come back to normal? You must have had a little rise in your creatinine. Has it come back to normal?
No, it's normal, same, 0.58.
Okay, perfect. Great, so we almost come to the end of the session, and while during this course of session, we did speak about may the act of love always win. And Mr. Ganesh so beautifully said that the immediate intuitional gut feeling that you have is never wrong. It is always giving you the right answer in terms of if you want to be a donor and if you have that instinct to be a donor, just go ahead. And that's what he followed. And I believe for me, that's something which is the same thing. That I think that's what you all have to follow. And what comes out from the outside world is immaterial. It's probably people's own emotions or lack of understanding of the act of donation by itself. But whatever said and done, I think self-love is the most important thing. You, like the simple theory goes, when we attend a flight, when you go onto a flight, you put on your mask first before putting on the mask even for your baby.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I think self-love is so important. So I need you both, while I know that you must be so much in love with your loved ones to do this act, I want you to tell us, how did you think of yourself first? And what was the promise you actually made to yourself when you decided to love another person? Because you can't love somebody if you don't love yourself, right? So, Mr. Ganesh, can you give me your view on that, please?
Yeah, absolutely. You're right. Like I said, self-preservation, self-love is the primary thing for everybody, whether you agree or whether you know it or not. So first thing I did was to keep myself fit. So post surgery, I do my regular walking exercise every day, 45 minutes. I do regular pranayam. I do whatever needs to be done to keep myself physically fit. I visit the doctor once in 3-4 months. I have my creatinuria tests, spot urine, spot creatinine. Once in a year, I have a thorough complete medical checkup, including treadmill, USG scan, etc. So far, I have not had any difficulty whatsoever with that. And as far as my wife is concerned, you know, like you talked about love, yes, we have to definitely do that for another human being. If it happens to be your wife's, so be it. But I think it's a larger canvas that I'm looking at. So any other human being, if you are able to be of some help, I think it should be done.
And remind us, how long back was your transplant done, Mr. Ganesh?
We had our transplant in 2016. So we just completed 5 years of transplant. Okay. And if it is out of context, I may add that when I finished my transplant and first review, my doctor said, normally when a woman's kidneys fail, the men look for a second wife. I said, it's too late. You should have told me before. Now it's too late now. But the sad part is 70% of women donate kidneys, but men don't do that. It's very, very sad. After all, if I had lost my kidneys, I'm sure my wife, like Shraddha had given for her husband, my wife would have given. I think the message should be that all men should come forward. More men should come forward to give kidneys to their better halves or to their sisters or to their mothers. I think that is a message I would want to leave in this whole session.
And Shraddha, how did you promise to love yourself?
I first thought of myself and then my husband and then kid. As we both, if we both are fit, and then we can look after to my daughter. And even my father-in-law and my mother and my father. So this made me to be a strong and positive mind. And then I put forward to donate it to my husband. So.
Thank you. And that brings us to the end of the session. And we have with us two super human beings who are the true example of love. And I'm quite overwhelmed sitting and talking to two people, one so young and one who's seen life and seen the act of marriage over the last 20 years. It's so beautiful to, 38 years, I forgot. 38 years. And it's just amazing to see how we could love another human being so much and put it into action. And like Mr. Ganesh said, it's not about just loving your wife or your brother or your sister, or your child, but it is loving another human. And if it doesn't do you any harm, we should have the courage to take this opportunity to donate our organs, at least take the opportunity to become cadaver donors once we die, because we don't lose anything at least then. So on that note, I'm going to request you, wherever you are, to please send some love, some energy, some blessings to these two beautiful souls sharing this screen with me. And thank you so much for joining me today. It's been a pleasure just talking to you. It's my privilege to actually know your stories and hear so much one-on-one on it. Thank you, Mr. Ganesh, and thank you, Shraddha.
Thank you. Thank you, Marianne. Thank you so much for giving us this opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you.